The battle itself kicks off 4:30 in the morning, June 16, 1862. We know that Isaac Stevens is the lead division in the frontal assault upon the Tower Battery. And the plan of the attack was that you would have a forlorn hope. You would have two companies of the 8th Michigan that would take the lead and would attempt the initial penetration of the fort. And the forlorn hope, like the rest of that division, was supposed to proceed without loaded weapons, that this was to be a bayonet attack that would take the fort by virtue of surprise. Now, this plan begins to go wrong almost from the very beginning, in that the 8th Michigan comes online about 1,000 yards from this fort where they begin to deploy, and the forlorn hope peels off in advance of the attack. And they begin a hurried or a quick march towards the fort, and they're followed again by the remainder of the 8th Michigan. What then happens is that the two follow-on regiments were to deploy side by side, spanning the width of the peninsula. But in the darkness, in the chaos of the moment, the 8th Michigan peels off and moves far in advance of the 7th Connecticut and the 28th Massachusetts. And they find themselves veering off diagonally into the pluff mud of an ever-narrowing peninsula. It's an assault that was not well planned. The peninsula begins to telescope, and they run into a marsh that's knee-deep that they can't negotiate, and then to make matters worse, artillery is about to come crashing into their ranks. By 4:30 in the morning, the attack has been revealed to the defenders of the Tower Battery. The forlorn hope of the 8th Michigan makes it to the parapet of the Tower Battery. And at which point, a couple of things happen. Number one, there's some chaos and turmoil outside, and members of the forlorn hope manage to sidle along the left flank of the fort and gain access into the fort along a small walkway or sally port. The first cannon to fire into the oncoming mass of troops is that 18-pounder, which is commanded by Sergeant Baggett. Sergeant Baggett will shortly lose his life in the gunfire and close combat that begins to swirl around his gun pit. The second big gun to go off is far to my right, and that is an 8-inch Columbiad being manned or being supervised at that moment in time by Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Lamar himself. Lamar has been an aggressive artillery commander, and it's that aggressive exchange of artillery that helped goad Henry Benham to action. This Lieutenant Colonel knows how to operate a piece. He has learned his trade, this planner, this lawyer, this legislator, this untrained soldier. And so he's there to go ahead and pull the lanyard. Lamar is also planned this thing out well. He did not anticipate an attack at this point in time, but he was ready should there have been an attack. Because coming in at that moment in time was a relief force. 100 or 150 men are, by the clock, are coming into the fort just as that attack begins to spill over the parapet. And they join this life or death struggle in this area of the fort. The first into the fort is the PD battalion, led by Alexander Smith. It's followed on by Peter Gilliard and the Charleston Battalion. By about 45 minutes, the 8th Michigan has largely been repelled and is on the other side, the outside of the parapet. We normally think about moats as having water and snapping alligators or crocodiles, but this is a dry moat. And the moat is on the exterior face of the fortification, and as they excavated this moat, they used a lot of that earthen material to create the parapet for the fort itself. And it's a parapet that would grow from the base of the moat itself roughly about 15 feet, 14 to 15 feet in height. What you would see are the gun positions from the exterior of the fort. And so here we are. We're now about 5:30 in the morning on June 16, 1862. And combat has swirled in and around the gun pits, and for the most part, those Union troops of the 8th Michigan have been ejected, and they cling, many of them cling to the outer wall of the fortification here. Confederates on the top shooting down the Unionists along the wall, clinging for dear life, trying to go ahead and return fire and retain the position. And despite the plan of there being reinforcements, there are no reinforcements. But the bottom line is the 8th Michigan largely fights this battle alone, though with primary assistance or some assistance from the 79th. And so by the time that we have the attack actually petering out over here in the Tower Battery, Union forces finally arrive at a position just across the marsh. The 3rd New Hampshire wheels, they look in the fort, they understand, they hear, they see all the sights. There are no trees during this period of time. This is all fairly tabletop. This is all land that's being used for Sea Island cotton when it's not a tidal marsh. And so they begin to advance and they begin to run into the Pluff Mud. They quickly realize that they are not going to go ahead and get across this tidal marsh. So they begin a long distance firing into the fort. It is now the arrival of the 4th Louisiana, and they begin a suppressive fire against the 3rd New Hampshire. There are casualties on both sides in this long distance shooting match, but what quickly turns the tide of battle yet again is not so much what's taking place here, but what's taking place far to the rear of the 3rd New Hampshire. And indeed, Confederate forces have arrived in the rear of Horatio Wright's division. And who begins to deal with that are the Rhode Island heavy artillerymen. They had followed on and they had to pivot and they engage Johnson Haygood and his men, and this firefight goes back and forth, back and forth. Coming into play are a couple, primarily a couple of artillery batteries. Ellison Capers arrives and he sees men who do not know how to use a cannon. But Capers, being that Citadel grad, familiar with artillery from his experience in the days of the Citadel, promptly teaches them how to get that or those pieces into action. They bring havoc into the Union force. The New Hampshiremen eventually evacuate. They retrace their steps. They start heading back toward the Stono River. Henry Benham now appears again on the battlefield. Henry Benham, who is the commander-in-chief of this operation, but yet has really exercised no control over the action himself. He has not shaped the battle. But Henry Benham, about 1,000 yards away from this, now is getting all the reports. He understands the chaos, the confusion, the lack of success here, and he orders a general retreat. Isaac Stevens, retracing his steps to Rivers Causeway and back to Soligree Island, and once again, Horatio Wright back to Grimmel's Plantation on James Island.
The actual battle fought at the Tower Battery only lasted a little more than 3 hours. The Confederates held their control of Charleston Harbor, at least for a time. Union Brigadier General Henry Benham was relieved of his command and eventually court-martialed for disobeying specific orders not to attack given by General Hunter. The Union suffered 683 casualties during those few hours, with 107 killed, 487 wounded, and 89 missing in action. The Confederates sustained 206 casualties, with 54 killed, 144 wounded, and 8 listed as captured or missing. Many of the fallen soldiers were buried in an unmarked mass grave in front of the parapet area. After the war, some buried Union and Confederate soldiers in this and other mass graves around Charleston were moved to the Beaufort National Cemetery. Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Lamar was shot in the neck during the fight. Lamar died a few months later, but from another cause, typhoid. Upon his death, the Tower Battery was renamed Fort Lamar in recognition of his stout-hearted leadership. The battery remained an important element in the Charleston defenses and was regularly engaged in long-range artillery dueling during the Siege of Charleston from 1863 to 1865. The Fort Lamar Heritage Preserve is owned and managed by the Department of Natural Resources and is open to the public.